Admit it. We've got a problem. Too much debt, too much leverage. People are addicted to it. Businesses are addicted to it. They can't get enough. There's no possible way that this can be turned around, though. So instead of attempting resolution, central banks and governments are trying to dig faster into this hole, just like they always have done throughout history. Not good. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today, we are going to look at what's happening with individuals and their debt. I'm also going to talk about the Federal Reserve. I want to show you their meeting minutes. I want to look at what's happening, of course, with the economy as well. A lot to cover in this one video. Let's begin. Millions of Americans skip credit card and car payments. You're looking at about 15 million credit card accounts and 3 million auto loans didn't get paid in April. Now, of course, as we'll talk about further, this shows you what people are doing because they're allowed to. If they get this idea that they don't really have to pay now for a 3-month period, do you think that some of those people, even if they could pay, are probably going to say, well, you know what, I'll just wait for the 3 months and see what happens? Of course, that's the way it works. Now, you have a lot of people, though, that are more busy trying to deal with the day-to-day life because they can't afford the food. They are living paycheck to paycheck, and they got their $1,200, but of course, that wasn't enough. They needed more. They're waiting for the next round of the $1,200, and all the while, they're going further into debt. This puts a real lot of pressure upon them, and of course, the further that they can push their debt back, the further they'll do that. I'll show you right now what the banks are saying. Millions of people are behind on their credit card and auto loan payments, and this is the financial devastation that we've seen throughout 2020. Lenders in April had nearly 15 million credit cards in financial hardship programs, such as deferral programs that let borrowers temporarily stop making payments. To be clear, that accounts for about 3% of the credit card accounts that the company tracks. Nearly 3 million auto loans were in these hardship programs, accounting for about 3.5% of those tracked. I've been showing you this as of 2019 up until the present, and we have seen an uptick regardless. It has gotten a lot worse because of everything that we are seeing today, but the trend wasn't looking good, especially when it comes to the auto loans. This is really the key, though. The spike in unemployment caused by the issue we are seeing right now has strained people's ability to make their monthly debt payments. To make matters worse, Americans were tapping credit cards and auto loans at record levels before 2020 to deal with the rising costs and stagnant incomes. What have we talked about 1,000 times on this channel? When you look at the real economy, when you look at real wages, at least the way that they measure it and what they call real, I put that in quotes, real. And then you look at the expansion of debt, and it has basically gone parabolic. And these two, they create this divergence in between them, and they go further and further apart as time goes on. I've ranted on about this so many times before. This was going on before 2020. I see the comments every single day. They refuse to acknowledge that, of course, but look at all the articles and the way that they're written. This is done in a way they're all unified. Every single article is basically the exact same information. All of the talking heads on the news giving you the same information in the same way. You think one is from one party or another supporting this party or this person or that person. You're completely incorrect. It's all a show. Everything is a show. You're watching a puppet show, and you need to look at the deeper detail that makes all of this up, but you can't see it, because if you think of it like this is the information that you can get, well, there's pieces of it all around here. And when you get on the news and you look in the articles and so on, you get this piece and you get this piece and you get this piece, and you can kind of put that together and you can make some sense of it, but you're not getting the whole picture, and that's why people get confused. Well, that's what I try to do. I try to piece it all together. Unfortunately, too many people are just distracted by nonsense. Anyway, enough ranting. Let me move on. Millions of Americans getting breaks on their loans are about to hear from their banks. Interesting. Forbearance programs from March are nearing their expiration dates, when many banks are set to decide whether to continue letting people put off roughly $150 billion in debt, including credit card balances, personal loans, and car payments. I would imagine that we may have to go beyond the 90 days of forbearance. Of course, people are going to push this off into the the future as much as possible. Why? Because it's a heck of a lot easier not to have another bill to worry about. The average person, they are absolutely living paycheck to paycheck. And in fact, that goes for people making over $100,000 a year. And that depends on what city you're in. That this $100,000, of course, doesn't look like an equal amount, you know, depending on where you are. But regardless, when I look at all of this information, I piece it all together. What I see here is that people have taken things too far. If they were getting, let's say, $80,000 a year or $60,000 a year, and over a 5-year period, now they're into that 100K, maybe they're making 120 and so on. What do? They go out and they get rid of their Honda and they sell that and they lease a new BMW. And that's right. Suddenly their payments went from $200 a month to $600 a month. But hey, that's only a few hundred dollars extra. Not going to be a big deal. I got this increase in my salary. I'll be totally fine. And what did they do? Because they got a new dog and they got a new this or that, and they needed a bigger home to put all that stuff in. So not a problem again, because when they stretch it out over a 30-year period, it turns out that it's a $1,000 increase. $1,000 increase, not going to be a problem because I got that raise. So I'm fine. And the point I'm trying to make is that as people's income increases, so does their expenses, so does their debt. So everybody basically is at the same level. Now, maybe they've got that 401k, but that's savings, right? You don't want to spend any of that money, but people are doing that. They are cashing in their 401ks, at least a percentage of it. And we see this all the time when people are put under pressure, and we haven't even begun. Look at what's going on with the pension funds. They are going to cut pensions from so many people, and they have no idea. Okay, I better stop ranting like this because the video is gonna have to be split in two, but look at this. Fed minutes shows fears of extraordinary amount of uncertainty and considerable risks. That's right, the Federal Reserve themselves said this, and of course the market reacted really negatively, right? No, of course not. They don't care. As long as they believe that the Federal Reserve is going to pump up the easy money, in fact, bad news is good news for the stock market. That's the way it works today. If the Federal Reserve will keep interest rates right at rock bottom, and hopefully they'll bring them into the negative, that's what the market really wants to see. If they do that, you know that the market's going to love it, because you know that the devaluation of currencies can definitely result in the nominal increase in what we see in different assets. Minutes from the Fed's April meeting show a deep concern not just about the current state of the economy, but what is ahead. And that's what we talk about here on the channel all the time. They also mention company bankruptcies and how that's going to affect the banking sector. Of course, this is very important. I believe I have an article about that in a moment. This is the actual meeting minutes themselves, and I just wanted to touch on this a little bit further. Participants saw risks to banks and some other financial institutions as exacerbated by high levels of indebtedness among non-financial corporations that prevailed before 2020. This indebtedness increased these firms' risk of insolvency. Haven't we talked about this literally thousands of times here on the channel? Of course, you and I both know what's going on. If you're here at this point in the video, we're both on the same page for the most part. Of course, there's a few psychopaths in here, but you and I, we know what's going on. This is what happens with all of these different institutions. They get themselves in so much debt. And why? Because the money is cheap. The money is free. If you borrow on your credit card, you're paying 17% interest. Depends on which credit card, of course. But that's the average, 17% interest. But the banks, these institutions get it cheap. They get it cheap. And then they loan it out to the average individual at extremely high rates, hoping that they can stretch that out as long as possible. If they run into any trouble, don't worry, they're going to get a bailout. Here's a quote from my friend Janet Yellen. Check this out. The Main Street program is going to be tremendously complicated. One of the problems with this program is that it may turn out to be, check this out, insufficiently generous. I love that wording there. But you don't have to worry, Janet, because you know the way the Fed works. They start with the QE1, then they bring in the QE2, and suddenly it's not QE anymore. Let's trick everybody. We'll call it not QE, and then we bring out QE4 and QE5. All of this is running at the same time. Nobody even knows what the hell is going on. It's a step-by-step process. Highly indebted zombie companies control more than 2 million US jobs. I'm not going to get into it any further. I just want to ask the question, what do you think is going to happen to these corporations as well as these jobs as you see conditions worsen? With the economy right now, even if things were to open up today, you still have the reverberation, a shockwave that is sent throughout the economy, and it cannot be resolved by loaning money to the company. That doesn't create demand. This is the senselessness of this model that they've created of central banking. I see the idiotic statements that are made all the time. Well, the problem is that all we need is some money right now, and then we'll be fine later, and you just don't understand how the economy works. I thought this was interesting. It is pessimistic, so you know you're going to get a few comments about that in the description. But anyway, Sundial says extreme option sentiment is an awful omen for stocks. What are they talking about here? Last week, the smallest of option traders, those with trades for 10 contracts or fewer at a time, opened a new record of net bullish positions. The bigger guys did not do the same. That has widened the spread between the small and large trader net bullish positions to a record, with the gap jumping like it did in 2008. Extremes in the data have consistently led to poor market returns. Doesn't necessarily tell us what's about to happen, but it's not a good sign. We have to face it. We have to understand that the average investor has no idea what's going on. If they use a particular service, they buy that stock. That's the way that they do it. Well, I think that this company is good, so I'm going to buy their stock. That's not investing. That's absolutely not investing, even if you hold it for a long period of time. That's speculation. The data from last week is disturbing. It clearly shows that the smallest of traders, who tend to be the most consistently ill-positioned at extremes, have gone aggressively long in a leveraged fashion. This has a strong tendency to lead to lower prices over the short to medium term. Leveraged is the key word, and unfortunately, so many people make this mistake. They will be burned. This article here is just talking about Jim Cramer and what he said, the FANG stocks, their performance, and so on. There's certainly been some aggressive moves on the way up, that's for sure. This article here is talking about cash and the way it's working today. I do believe we are going towards a cashless society. I did a post about this in my blog or community section on the channel, as well as Twitter and so on. It's interesting to see the way that this is going, and there's no doubt about it that this is going to create a leap forward or backward. I don't know how you want to look at this. Either way, it's not a good sign. My friends in the UK, check this out. Bank of England paves the way for negative interest rates. Governor says all options are open after the UK sells the first ever bond with negative yield. The whole world is going in that direction, and it shows you the value of your money. That's all for this video. If you found it informative, hit that thumbs up button. When you do, you're supporting me. Thank you very much. If you want to check me out, Instagram, Twitter, @TheMoneyGPS. Right now, online sales have picked up dramatically, and this is so important. It's a skill for people to have, to learn. For some strange reason, I decided to make my course free, even though all the others out there charging $1,000 plus. If you want to get in, the AmazonGPS.com. For those who want to know about the financial system to understand all of it, but not get all that jargon, these two books will explain it for you in plain English. Check it out at the link in the description if you want the audiobook, moneygps.com. Wait a second, don't go anywhere. Have you seen this? It's extremely important, and hope that more people will definitely check it out. If you want to, click it. I'll see you there.